Today, we're talking knives. If you're gonna get into anything in the outdoors, you probably already understand you need a good knife, a good blade, something to cut stuff with. You don't have to obsess over it, but you need to know the basics. I'm a big fan of this Bushcraft knife from Moore & Knieve, but there is a ton of variation. If you were to go and pick up yourself a Moore knife, you might actually be surprised that there actually is a lot of variation. And as you can see, they're all different in minor ways. So I'm gonna walk through today all of the things you might need to know when you're starting out. Okay, let's talk about knife anatomy. There's a lot of variations in knives, but what I'm gonna do is I'm going to talk about the basic anatomy of a knife like this. This is the Moore Garberg. It's a beautiful Bushcraft knife from Moore & Knieve, and they market this as their survival type knife. And I will use this knife to let us walk through the different terminology so we're all on the same page when we're talking about knives. Okay, first you have the blade. That's what cuts. It can be made of lots of different types of metal. We'll get to that in a second. Now most of the time, this side is your edge. That's the cutting edge. And then this side is the spine. Up here you have the point. The bevel on the bottom refers to how the metal is ground to give the cutting edge. More on that in a second. Sometimes you have serrations on your blade, even on the back, which is handy if, say, you're cutting through a rope. The tang refers to how far the metal goes into the handle. In this case, it goes all the way through and is full tang. This is the butt or pommel, which you can use to pound things or, say, break glass. And this is a little lanyard hole. Okay, now let's talk about tang. Tang is a great way to start talking about knife construction. So I have a couple of knives here just so we can start talking about it. This one here is full tang. So the metal starts at the blade, goes all the way through the handle to the end and to the butt. And that makes it really strong. So if you were going to cram it into a crevice and start prying, or say you're battening wood, this would be the knife that you would want to use it for. So it makes it really nice for having a survival knife or a bushcraft knife. This one is partial tang. This is the companion. That means that the blade here comes down into the handle only to about here. So the handle is surrounding the metal a little bit more. And there are lots of different types of partial tang, but you wouldn't want to crank on a blade like this so much because you could break it. Now the construction on these Moore knives is really good, and it's molded plastic on the end here, and you're not gonna have to worry about it too much. But as a contrast, this is a really cheap knife that I got from a Florida gas station because I thought it kind of looked cool and I was just passing through. But what happened is it's also partial tang. The metal only goes in about this far because it's hollow in the handle, so you can put rope and matches. But the handle is wiggling. It's totally loose because just with a little bit of use, it became unusable. So this is something to think about when you're getting a knife. All right, metals. When you're talking about steel, it's important to understand that it is an alloy of iron. So iron itself is fairly flexible, it bends, it's not extremely strong, but when you add stuff to it, then you get steel. Now you can add lots of different things. The ratio of stuff that you add can vary, and that's why you have so many different types of steels. And most of those are what you're going to get your blades out of. So you have this one, which is high carbon steel. So it has 1 to 2% carbon mixed in. That's stronger. It's sometimes more brittle in ways, but it's really stiff and rigid. You get a really sharp edge on it. But you're gonna have to maintain it more because it could rust a little bit easier on you. And then you have stainless steel. So this one right here is stainless steel. And this is really nice because it resists corrosion quite a lot. Stainless steel has chromium mixed in. And then you have something right here. This is called laminated steel. And this is one of their carving knives. Laminated steel is high carbon steel on the inside. And then they mold a softer metal, kind of press it onto the outside. So you actually have two metals on top of each other here. Essentially, it maximizes sharpness and long life. Now, the last one you might come across is Damascus steel. They look beautiful, though. My friend Hazen makes all of his knives out of Damascus steel, so I thought he'd give us a quick overview of his knife.
Hi, Rob and everybody. Here are some Damascus blades. See how beautiful those patterns are? These patterns basically tell the story of how these blades are made. Continually folding the steel, so wherever the steel is exposed to carbon, they can fold that into the steel and fold it into the steel and fold it into the steel. If you ever take something like two different colors of Play-Doh, you sandwich them together and you start manipulating them and you get this really amazing swirl pattern. And that's what it is. These different colors, these different bands of steel, indicate the different alloys of steel that are bonded together, whether they have more carbon or more chromium or whatever is in the steel. Is Damascus a better steel than today's modern high-performance steels? Not necessarily. I, for myself, love the steel. It is still high-performance. And it tells a story. It's beautiful. I mean, why not surround yourself with beautiful things? And if you're going to work with a beautiful tool, have something that you can be proud of. All these blades here are going to be the knives that I'm going to be using for this new year of Primal Survivor. Back to you, Rob.
To get an edge, you're going to take a flat piece of metal. You're going to grind it down until it's sharp on one side. Now, here's a quick overview of a few of the ways to grind a blade. Now, I'm not going to go into why each one is beneficial, but I did want to give you this quick overview. Most of these Mora knives are actually Scanda grinds, which means you can see right here that with this flat piece of metal, the way they got the edge is they ground down the metal flat straight into the edge. That makes it really easy to work with in the field, and that's partly why I like these Scanda grinds. But there are other ones too, like for instance, you can have a hollow grind. Hollow grinds are great for skinning animals. They're really sharp. They're a little bit weaker at the surface. Now, opposite of that is a convex grind. You can also have a saber grind, a chisel grind, which is only ground on one edge, and a flat grind. It's important to know that there are variations. But let's get to what I think is more fun, fire starting. Fire starting! Crazy, right? These two knives have different abilities to be used by a fire starter. This one you can use a fire starter with, this one you can't. Why is that? It has nothing really to do with whether or not it's carbon or stainless, although that helps depending if you're using, say, flint and steel, that kind of thing. It has most of it to do with the grind on the spine right here. So this is actually a companion knife. They made specifically with the fire starting in mind right here. This is the fire starter. And this is a stainless steel blade. You could do a carbon blade with it too, but watch how this strikes like that. I gotta be careful on this wooden table. And this is a carbon blade. Both will work if the spine is ground to a 90 degree angle and not polished. So this one here, it's really fine and polished. It looks beautiful. And if you rub along the spine, it's really smooth. It will all day, I will not be able to use a fire starter with this one. And sometimes you're using it out in the field and you want that. Sheaths. There are lots of different types of sheaths, and I won't even go into the differences. You got leather ones and plastic and form-fitting. You'll find the one that's right for you. If you're doing survival stuff, it's kind of nice to have one like this where you have a ferro rod in it, and it also has a sharpening stone on the edge like that. But no, you got to go into the field with an actual sheath, or you won't be able to carry your knife at all. Now, I talked today about a lot of knives, and I have this whole selection from Mora Knieve because I can show you some different variations. Like, you have a knife here with serrations. You've got this knife, which is the Cansbowl, which has a very sharp front edge and is lightweight, but really good for, say, hunting applications. You have this one, which is small and light. I think they call this the Eldis. This one has in the handle a fire starter. This one only has serrations on half of the blade. Here's one with a blunt tip, which has a floating handle. Here's their classic with a wood handle. You've got one made for carving, made out of laminated steel. The kids' blades are really cool. They have little hand guards for the fingers. Here's their basic, which is only 10 bucks, so it's a great starter knife. These are full tang. At this stage, I'm gonna bring in Jonas, because I think you might be wondering, why are we only showing the Mora knives from Mora Knieve? And why is it, if you're familiar with the brand, that some people pronounce it in many different ways?
The Mora Carbon.
Mora Knieve.
The Mora Knieve Classic.
Well, to help me with that, Jonas, who lives in Sweden, could give us a little history lesson and a background on the pronunciation.
Hey Rob, yep, I'm here in a wintry landscape in Sweden. Mora Knives is a Swedish brand. And to be honest, it's something that pretty much all Swedes have grown up with. I remember when I was young, I was gonna go out and get my first bushcraft knife for Boy Scouts. I didn't just go out and buy a knife. I went out to get my first Mora knife. That's kind of how it was. It's part of tradition. Everyone here is familiar with the brand name Mora Knieve. The name then in itself, Mora, the first half of the name, is a town in central Sweden that I actually took Rob to a few years ago because it's famous for something else as well. And that is the longest public cross-country skiing race in the world. It is part of Swedish tradition as well. This town is also where they make the knives. Kniv is the Swedish word for knife, so essentially the brand name Mora Kniv means Mora knives, so that's where it comes from. So, Mora Kniv is how you pronounce it here in Swedish, Mora knife in English, I would say. So there you have it, a short history lesson and a little explanation about the name. All right, back to you, Rob.
The reason I made this was just so that you could understand what it was you needed to get, then get it, and now start using it. That's the most important thing, is just figuring out how to use the knives. Also, I just wanted to say a big thank you to my patrons who are supporting this Outdoor Basics series. It's gonna be 8-part series, and I just wanna get these out of the way, and then we can get into what I think is the fun stuff, which is about the plants and the animals, understanding nature.
And don't forget, this is part of continued education for Mother Nature Is Not Trying to Kill You, a new book Haley and I wrote. Check out the full outdoor series playlist there. More videos, subscribe to the channel. You know how it works. We got new videos every Monday.